U.S. President Joe Biden is the latest world leader to get stricken with COVID-19. The Asian Development Bank raising its growth forecast for the Philippines. A lawmaker advises President Marcos to seek special powers to address rising inflation. Later on in the program, we'll speak with former Social Welfare Secretary Judy Taguibano on the launch of their campaign to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the Declaration of Martial Law. And we'll also have Vilas Pilipinas head coach Chot Reyes on the team's recent dismal performance and how they plan to move forward. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. Our top story at this hour. U.S. President Joe Biden becomes the latest world leader to test positive for COVID-19. Biden's doctors say the 79-year-old is experiencing mild fatigue and would isolate at the White House while carrying out his full duties. According to the White House, Biden is taking Pfizer's antiviral drug Paxlovid to minimize the severity of the disease. On Twitter, Biden posted a picture of himself working at his desk and apologized for missing a scheduled event in Pennsylvania. He also used the platform to allay concerns about his condition.
Hey folks, guess you heard. This morning I tested positive for COVID. But I've been double vaccinated, double boosted. Symptoms are mild. And I really appreciate your inquiries and your concerns. But I'm doing well. I'm getting a lot of work done. I'm going to continue to get it done. And in the meantime, thanks for your concern and keep the faith. It's going to be okay.
Biden had planned to spend more time on the ground in the U.S. in the coming weeks. After a period of intense travel, including a NATO summit in Spain and a controversial trip to Saudi Arabia. Three antiviral drugs prescribed in Japan may be effective against the Omicron BA.5 subvariant. A team led by a professor of virology at the University of Tokyo found that molnupiravir, remdesivir, and nirmatrelvir curbed virus activity in cultured monkey cells infected with the highly contagious subvariant and other strains. BA.5 is currently driving a surge of infections in Japan and elsewhere in the world. The country's daily cases exceeded 150,000 for the first time Wednesday. No new curbs have been implemented despite the surge. Here at home, the Philippines reported 2,828 new COVID infections Thursday. That's the highest daily tally in over 5 months. 1,000 of the new cases are from Metro Manila. Active cases now stand at 22,207. Health experts again urging Filipinos to get their booster shots following the emergence of the new BA.2.75 Omicron subvariant. It has been detected in at least 10 countries and is said to be 18 times more transmissible than the original Omicron strain.
If you look at the genetic tree of the Omicron variant as they evolve, there is always that increased transmissibility and the ability to evade the vaccines.
Booster dose ay nag-expand, nagbo-broaden yung kanyang immune response, yung mga iba-ibang klase niyang mga antibodies, for instance, na mako-cover kasama yung mga variants. So meron silang mga pag-aaral ngayon na okay pa naman.
Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista is the latest Marcos cabinet member to test positive for COVID-19. Bautista is now in isolation. He is exhibiting mild symptoms, including headache and cough. He is expected to miss President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s first State of the Nation address on Monday. The Philippine Disaster Management Agency has started coordinating with officials of the National Task Force Against COVID-19. This as the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council takes over the functions of the NTF. The Department of National Defense, which handles the NDRRMC, believes the restructuring will result in improvements in the country's pandemic response.
Just like any calamity, you know, ganun din naman ang pagtrato ng NDRRMC sa COVID-19. Ang kaibahan lang nito ay ongoing, ano, tuloy-tuloy siya. At nung nagsimula nung 2019 ito, nagiging ano na siya, ika nga, new normal. So ang mangyayari lang, para madadagdagan na lang ang isang contingency na kailangan i-handle ng NDMC. I think mas makakaayos pa nga ito kasi magiging sa ilalim na lang ng isang umbrella organization lahat na nung ating mga disasters at potential na mga emergencies. At mabuti yan, nakasama na rin yung ang COVID-19 turn dito sa NDMC.
In other news, a lawmaker wants President Marcos to declare rising inflation as public enemy number one during his first State of the Nation address on Monday. Albay Representative Joey Salceda says Marcos should present specific programs geared towards helping sectors most affected by soaring fuel and commodity prices. He says the president may even ask Congress to grant him special powers.
Calling out, for example, the AFP and, you know, all the others, the uniform personnel, in order to finish certain infrastructure na sa ngayon po nakabinbin at para po hindi po magkaroon ng logistical bottleneck, isa na po yan. Pangalawa, yung pagbibigay po ng loans o ng mga ayuda sa mga MSME na para po mag, kasi sa ngayon, ba, may budget, pero wala po ngayon sa GAA, sa GAA. She should have that power to use savings and augment without having to go through Congress and augment those funds.
Salceda also wants Marcos to increase government's infrastructure spending. He's likewise in favor of renegotiating loan agreements struck with China for railway projects worth nearly $5 billion. The deal was earlier scrapped due to China's failure to act on the funding requests.
The North-South Commuter Railway, the PNR South Long Haul, as well as, of course, the Mindanao Railways are very critical infrastructure project. We can easily find others. But I think as of now, the better option really is now that the Chinese says, okay, we will talk about it again. I think basically let's talk about it. Because, for example, for Bicol, I've seen 17 status report already on that project. So I don't know why we should just suddenly withdraw from it.
Senator Sonny Angara also expects President Marcos to give solutions to rising prices, particularly in terms of agricultural inputs. Angara believes while the new administration's plan to import cheap fertilizers will help farmers lower production costs, there may be a better way to go about it in the long run.
Fertilizer is one of the most important inputs, no? So although merong short-term measures like this, dapat yung nabanggit natin yung tatak din. Also, look to maybe establishing your own industry. Because if you're using this product every day, if it's crucial to your national development and to your progress, then why not have a strong domestic industry in the long run? Meron ng mga developments dyan on a small level, especially yung ating mga state universities and colleges.
Malacanang has denied an online report claiming Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez has quit his post. Our very own Pia Gutierrez now on the line with that story. Pia, over to you.
Yes, Carmina, that's right. The palace is denying that Attorney Vic Rodriguez has resigned his post as Executive Secretary. In a text message to the Malacanang media, Press Secretary Trixie Cruz Angeles said that an online report claiming that Rodriguez resigned supposedly due to pressure in the Marcos administration's inner circle is simply not true. Rodriguez has yet to respond to media queries, but what we know is that he said to meet with officers of the Malacanang Press Corps at the palace this afternoon. I have yet to clarify. I have to clarify that this is not a press conference, as cameras are supposedly not allowed during the meeting. But this meeting is a simple courtesy call by the MPC officers to Rodriguez, though we are expecting that matter to be clarified during the meeting. Carmina, we will be giving you more updates as they come.
All right. Thanks a lot. Pia Gutierrez there joining us on the line. Take care, Pia, and you keep safe. Back here in the newsroom, Activists on Thursday launched a campaign. It's called ML50. It's supposed to highlight abuses committed during the martial law regime of the father and namesake of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. The campaign aims to counter attempts to whitewash that brutal period of our history. Ahead of the 50th anniversary of the declaration of martial law, joining us now is ML50 co-convener, former Social Welfare Secretary Judy Tagiwaloa. Judy, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today and welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina. Good afternoon to the viewers.
All right, so I want to talk, we're going to talk about ML50 in a bit, but there was an incident that happened yesterday after the press conference, and I want to talk to you more about that first. Do we exactly know why there was police presence at that location where you were holding your press conference? Is there any clarity at all now to what happened yesterday?
Well, that indicates to you what is happening now. I mean, in peaceful assemblies, in private venues, of oppositionists, of critics of the Marcoses because of the martial law experience and of the current issues in our country, have been guarded, quote-unquote, by security forces. This is not the first time, actually, Carmina. Last June 30, we're at the Bantayog ng mga Bayani, again, to register as martial law victims at during the inauguration of Marcos Jr., that we stand against historical distortion. Mm-hmm. There were also police forces outside mm-hmm. Bantayog ng mga Bayani. Mm-hmm. So this yesterday's happening was not an isolated one. And it strikes major concern for us because it brings back memories again of martial law. As far as we know, the Constitution, 1907 Constitution still operates and allows freedom of assembly. So their presence yesterday was very much unwelcome and we think violative of our rights.
Well, Judy, clearly there was an order for the police forces to be there yesterday. Where did the order emanate from? And what was the order? Do you know?
Actually, I don't know. Okay, it was Bayan Chair Carol Araulio who was out there. I was still inside the venue, being interviewed by young people. Mm-hmm. So by the time the event happened, I was not able to join them. Mm-hmm. Whatever the order is, definitely, it is uncalled for. It is a violation of our right to assembly.
A while ago you were saying, Judy, but that by their mere presence there, it's reminiscent of what you guys had to go through during the martial law regime. It sort of reinforces, in a way, right, in a roundabout way, why you're commemorating the declaration of martial law. Why is it important, Judy, to have to continue to commemorate the declaration of martial law, even now that the sitting president is the only son of the late dictator?
Yes. This year, it marks the 50th year of the declaration of martial law in 1972. And the irony is, the Marcoses, and their supporters and their cohorts called that period as the golden years. I mean, for many of the Filipinos, for millions who suffered during the martial law period, it was far from golden. But definitely, it was golden for the Marcoses and for their cronies, as shown by many, many documented accounts of the plunder, of the human rights violations, of the lavish lifestyle, and the monopoly of power that they had. The Marcos Restoration brings about the possibility, no, that the golden years myth will be further disseminated. And we can see that already in the cultural field, you know, with attempts to romanticize the Marcoses family in a forthcoming movie. Mm-hmm. So martial law at 50 is a educational, cultural movement to reiterate the actual events during the martial law period that was not golden, that it allowed the Marcoses to stay in power for over 21 years, when in fact, the Constitution at that time would have allowed them only to stay for the maximum of 8 years. Mm. But martial law allowed them to stay on and on until people power ousted them from Malacanang.
You know, let's talk about what's happening right now. People have called it distortion, revisionism. The other side, though, saying that it's their own version of the truth. It's their version of what happened then. Call it romanticization, romanticization or not, having to romanticize things or not. They're saying it's their right to air their side of the story and that this is their own version of the truth. What do you say to that?
Well, if it's a private family reunion and they're talking among themselves, we wouldn't be bothered about it. But these are people in power now. They use this kind of distortion, disinformation, to deceive people to believe that they were victims. Imagine, I can't imagine victims having shopping spree at Bulgaris, victims having buildings at Manhattan, or, you know, you cannot believe that. And seeing all the jewelry and the paintings that they have, martial law was a time for them to reign like royalty. And it has meant, like, for them, Malacanang is home rather than the home of the Filipino people. So we're saying, no, that is unacceptable. We stand for the truth, and the distortion of the truth must be resisted with all our might for all the victims that fell during the martial law years, as well as for this new generation of Filipino youth who really came out and last election, who wanted good governance, who wanted social justice, who wanted truth.
I want to take the other side's perspective now, because clearly there's a there's a gap, Judy. And we're still trying to figure out why is it that there are some people who think that what happened during the dark days of martial law has nothing to do with them. Why should, you were talking about it is unacceptable to you, but why should it be acceptable to them, all these horror stories, what the victims had to go through, the disappearances that had happened during that time, the famine that happened during that time? Why should it be acceptable to them, given that they said it themselves, it was a golden era of the Philippines? Judy.
Acceptable for whom? For those who believe in them?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, many of them are cronies or were cronies. Definitely, they benefited from the dictatorship, as we see from all the videos, the pictures of the parties in Malacanang, even abroad. But for the majority of the Filipino people, who believe that, you know, the Marcoses are telling the truth, I think partly it comes from, you know, the failure of the previous administration to institutionalize what actually happened during the martial law period through our educational system, through setting up memorials, as what they did in Germany, as what they did in Gwangjong, Korea, after the massacre in Gwangjong. There was that failure. So the distortion provided a new opening for them. Secondly, the Filipino people, the majority of the Filipino people's lives have not improved since the ouster of the Marcoses. It was bad during the Marcos years. Definitely, inflation was very high. Poverty, you've said malnutrition, you have seen nourishment. And then in contrast, the lifestyle of the Marcoses. But after the EDSA, you know, the economic reforms that people wanted, like lower poverty rates, farmers having land, work inside the Philippines rather than abroad, that hasn't happened. And the pandemic has made it worse. So it became fertile ground to create that illusion that life during the Marcoses were better. But aside from that, Karina, they have massive resources. They have massive resources. It's not just a question of mind conditioning, but also paying people to spread that kind of information. And we know that, and they know that. Mm-mm. Through all armies.
I mean, they can spread all they want, Judy, but the fact of the matter is, there are people who have been willing and eager to believe. How do you get across your message to these people who have been led to believe otherwise?
Well, we will continue with speaking out, with presenting the evidence, the truth through various means. Well, Joel Mangan is trying to raise funds to make a movie. You have books, movies, etc. That's one aspect. That's the cultural aspect. But I think the important thing now is really how are the Filipino people's lives going to be better under this dispensation, under the promise of, you know, the son of the dictator who gave us the quote-unquote golden years. Problem still remains. Massive unemployment, joblessness, hunger, now very high prices. What is he going to do about it? Mm-mm. And I think that's where the tipping point will come. Mm-mm. Through the information campaign, but the actual record that is going to take place in his administration.
Mm-hmm. And Judy, what do you say to those who think and who actually say it? Marshalo na naman. Yan na naman. Paulit-ulit na naman yung pinag-uusapan. What does the past have to do with the current president? Ano ba ang koneksyon? Bakit ba kailangan pag-usapan ng pag-usapan yung Marshalo na yan na paulit-ulit na lamang ninyong binabanggit? What do you say to people who think that and say that out loud?
Wala pang justice, Karina, eh. Diba? The missing are still missing. The plundered money has not been fully returned. Even the conviction, even the imprisonment of those convicted. Remember, Imelda Marcos was convicted in 2018 of 7 counts of graft and the 203 billion back taxes. These are all related to the martial law period. So it's not just a question of, you know, stop talking about the past, that's done, move on. No, it is still the continuing past. By the fact that the sins of the family have not been atoned for. Walang pagsisisi. In fact, they're going to say, point of view namin ito. Point of view namin ito. But maraming natamaan, maraming nanakaw, maraming hindi pa nabigyan ng hustisya. So, never forget is very important. In the same manner, si Hitler, ilang taon na yan napatay sa Germany. But it remains a continuing campaign of the German government and the German people to make sure that the German people never forget what he did to Germany and to the world. Ganyan din dapat sa diktadurang Marcos. Never forget, never again, to refuse all forms of tyranny, to refuse the repetition of plunder, graft and corruption and impunity. Ayaw natin nangyari sa kanila yung nangyari sa amin. Diba?
And finally, Judy, you know, in his inaugural address, President Marcos then said he's not here to talk about the past, he's here to talk about our future. That's what he said during the inaugural address. So we're just counting a couple of days before his first State of the Nation address. What are your expectations when he talks about the future of the Filipino people? What do you want to hear from him that would tell you that he is indeed serious about the future of the Filipino people and not the future of his family, Judy?
Well, the economic crisis should be addressed, but not dependent on importation again. The issue of the charges against the previous president, we stand regarding the investigation of the ICC, should also be addressed. The issue of the health system, you know? The health system is really in a bad state as the pandemic has shown us. And the issue of justice for victims of human rights violations, not only during the Marcos years, but until now, you know, and then the issue of peace. These are issues that have been mentioned by the people in various surveys. So we'll see what is he going to talk about. But more importantly, I think it is also the issue of national sovereignty. Are we going to stand as an independent nation vis-a-vis China and the United States? Mm. So we're looking at good governance. We're looking at human rights. We're looking at justice.
Former DSWD Secretary and ML50 co-convener Judy Tagiwalo. Maraming salamat po. Thank you for joining us today. Take care. Keep safe. And we're going to take a break now. Up ahead, government's right-sizing efforts could force some state workers to retire earlier. More on that story when we return. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC. And we are back. Here's Scylla, Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. U.S. President Joe Biden is the latest world leader to get stricken with COVID-19. The Asian Development Bank raising its growth forecast for the Philippines. And a lawmaker advises President Marcos to seek special powers to address rising inflation. Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte Carpio is in Bohol to inspect typhoon-damaged schools in the province. Our very own Annie Perez now joins us with details. Annie, what more can you tell us?
Yes, Carmina, the Vice President and the Secretary of Education has assured the people of Bohol that she will do her best to repair the classrooms that were severely hit by Typhoon Odette. Earlier today, Vice President Sara Duterte visited schools that had been damaged, such as of Clarine National School of Fisheries. Duterte held a closed-door meeting with the top officials from the regional level of the Education Department. She also accepted the folders, which contained the scope of work of the schools whose classrooms are bound for major repairs. DepEd 7 Regional Director Salustiano Jimenez already earlier said that in the region, there are about 5,000 classrooms that were totally damaged after the typhoon in December 2021, while about 2,000 only need minor repairs. With the assurance of the Education Secretary, Jimenez said, they are confident that when full face-to-face classes start this November, their learners can use classrooms. But in the event that they would not be repaired on time, Jimenez said, they have made plans to conduct shifting of classes so that classrooms can all be utilized by the students. About 92% of the schools in Central Visayas region has already been implementing limited face-to-face classes. So that means they are ready for the full implementation this November. 6,000 schools are already conducting this scheme. The Vice President then proceeded to attend the celebration of the province's 168th founding anniversary, which they call the Bohol Day. In her speech, she thanked the Boholanos for their support and continued to ask for cooperation among the people towards the new administration. She further commended the spirit of remembering cultural and historical events that took place in the province. After the celebration, she was set to have a private lunch with the province's top officials. And that's the latest from Central Visayas, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Annie Pettis, there joining us on the line. Take care, Annie. Keep safe. Back here in the newsroom, the Civil Service Commission allays fears about the government's right-sizing move, which is feared to result in massive layoffs. CSC Commissioner Aileen Lasada says this initiative does not necessarily mean government will simply remove workers from their positions. She now suggests lowering the retirement age to make right-sizing efforts more enticing to government employees.
We have the oldest mandatory retirement in the whole of ASEAN countries po. And we also have the oldest optional age of retirement. So those who are doing the right sizing, baka ho pwede niyong tingnan yung option na to. Kasi this is also good to infuse younger, younger generation. So, and give the others who would like to retire a time with their family or small business to get the support of the employees po for the right sizing or for any event regarding this mga streamlining or rationalization, whatever we call it. The package must be that enticing.
The new U.S. ambassador to the Philippines, Mary Kay Carlson, now in Manila. The U.S. embassy confirmed Carlson's arrival in a tweet late Thursday night. Carlson also tweeted pictures as she formally presented her credentials to the Philippine Department of Foreign Affairs. She says she looks forward to exploring great opportunities for bilateral relations. Carlson previously served as deputy chief of mission at the U.S. embassy in Buenos Aires, Argentina, and has been with the Foreign Service since 1985. A New York man has been indicted on multiple hate crime charges for allegedly punching an elderly Filipino woman more than 100 times. Tamil Esco pleaded not guilty. He is being held without bail. The March 11 attack, which was caught on surveillance video, showed the woman about to enter her apartment building when Esco came up behind her and knocked her to the ground. Prosecutors say he also hurled racial slurs at the 67-year-old woman. The victim suffered brain bleeding and multiple facial fractures, among other injuries. And still in the U.S., a heat wave is expected to scorch the East Coast and the South for a third day. Heat warnings are in effect from South Carolina up to parts of New England. The heat index is expected to reach 41 degrees Celsius in Washington, D.C. Weather officials urge people to stay indoors and to stay hydrated. The heat wave in the U.S. follows scorching conditions in Western Europe, where temperatures soared to as high as 45 degrees Celsius. Scientists warn the record-breaking heat will become more frequent, no thanks to climate change. Ukraine and Russia set to sign a deal allowing grain exports to cross the Black Sea. Turkey says the agreement was reached during talks led by the United Nations in Istanbul last week. No other details of the deal were given, but it reportedly will be signed in Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan's office Friday. The deal aims to relieve a global food crisis as Russia's war stalled Kyiv's exports, leaving millions of tons of grain stuck in Ukrainian ports. The U.S. welcomes the deal and urges Russia to implement it. In Sri Lanka, security forces raid the main camp of anti-government protesters in the capital early Friday. Armed with batons and assault rifles, the troops evicted the activists and demolished the camp, which was set up at a government building. This came hours before President Ranil Wickramasinghe was scheduled to name his cabinet. The protesters had vowed to vacate the camp they held since April after a new cabinet has been sworn in. Sri Lanka is under a state of emergency that gives sweeping powers to law enforcement. And we're going to take another break now. Still ahead, the Asian Development Bank paints a rosy growth outlook for the Philippines. The latest in business plus sports. When Dateline Philippines returns, stay with us here on ANC. And we're back with more news. The Asian Development Bank reveals a more optimistic growth outlook for the Philippines. It predicts the country's GDP growth to hit 6.5% this year, higher than its previous forecast of 6%. The ADB says growth will be fueled by relaxed COVID restrictions, expanded vaccination coverage, and household consumption. Its forecast is within government's growth target of 6.5% to 7.5%. But its outlook, make that outlook for the rest of Asia not so promising. The ADB slashed its fourth make-at growth forecast for developing Asia for 2022. It now expects the region's GDP growth to slow to 4.6% from April's of 5.2%. The ADB cited the growing fallout from the Ukraine-Russia conflict for the downgrade. A Philippine consumers group opposes a petition that seeks to adjust the power supply agreements of two energy firms, but power distributor Meralco warns the move may backfire. Alvin El Chico reports.
Power utility Meralco warns of rotational power interruptions or higher electricity rate if the Energy Regulatory Commission denies the petition of two power plants of San Miguel Corporation to adjust rates in order to cover higher fuel prices. Meralco has joined the petition of San Miguel Energy Corporation and South Premier Power Corporation to recover over 5 billion pesos from consumers due to soaring fuel prices not covered by the approved power supply agreement. Meralco says if the SMC-owned plant cease to supply power to the utility, it will have dire consequences on consumers.
Dalawa lang ang pwedeng maging impact nito sa consumers, no? Kung wala kaming makuha, edi naturally magkakaroon tayo ng rotational brownout, di ba? At kung may makuha man kami sa mas malaking presyo, mas malaki naman ang babayaran ng customers.
But consumer group Power for People filed an opposition to the petition of the ERC, insisting that the recovery is a violation of the contract between Meralco and the power plants.
Bakit kapag ang mga kumpanya ay kumikita ng labis-labis sa panahon ng mataas ang presyo ng kuryente, pinapasa sa electric consumers ay okay lang. And now, na parang may problema, ay at the brunt uli ng electric consumers. So parang hindi ata tama.
Ang nangyayari ngayon, mas malaki pa ang increase kaysa sa 3.5%. So hindi talaga na-factor in yan. So yun ang ipinapaliwanag namin sa regulator kung anong relief ang pwedeng maibigay sa ganitong mga pagkakataon.
Power for People says this is a problem when a huge portion of the country's power mix relies on coal and other fossil fuel.
Ito ay clear example ng una, mahirap talagang mag-rely sa fossil fuel importation. The last decade have shown us na ang increase ng ating kuryente ay related sa increase ng importation ng coal at ng natural gas.
While Meralco says that the petition is urgent, the Energy Regulatory Commission explains it will have to go through a thorough process as it will likely affect consumers.
Ano man pong inihain sa komisyon na magagalaw or mag-a-adjust ng ating taripa, lalo na po pagpataas, hindi po yan ora-ora na i-implementa dahil inaaral po yan mabuti para po sa protection ng consumers.
The current ERC can hear and decide on the petition as the remaining four commissioners still constitute a quorum after its chairperson, Agnes de Banadera, retired last week. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
And time now for the latest in sports. We're joined today by the content lead of ABS-CBN Sports, Migs Bustos. Migs, nice to see you. Over to you.
Thank you, Casey. The Philippine National Basketball Program, Giles Pilipinas, hopes to get a much-needed boost in the upcoming FIBA World Cup Asian qualifiers with the possible return of NBA star Jordan Clarkson to its lineup. The Sixth Man of the Year winner is keeping himself busy this offseason by teaching the next generation of hoop stars. Steve Angeles has more.
Little ballers, big dreams.
I'm hoping to play NBA, maybe even go to the finals. Nice. Or be a Hall of Famer.
These Philam middle school basketball players spent 2 days learning from their role model, the most decorated Filipino to ever play in the NBA, Jordan Clarkson, even running a few pickup games with the Utah Jazz guard as he held his annual youth summer camp in Corona, California.
I learned to make more shots, more handles.
My first thought was, he's just really tall. It's hard to guard him too. They talk a lot of things like how basketball is supposed to be a fun game, and then when you compete, it gets even funner.
And after running the courts and scrimmaging with the young prospects, Clarkson also offered some life advice to the campers.
Just keep chasing your dreams. I wasn't highly ranked, highly touted, nothing. I just kind of came out of nowhere. Then I got drafted in the second round, and my story's been whatever it is since then. All I'm going to say is keep chasing your dreams. Don't let nobody tell you nothing that you can't do. Keep grinding. Put the time in if you want to do this. But if you want to do something else, that's art, be a lawyer, doctor, whatever it is, just put your time in and work hard at it.
Obviously, he's touching people. He's touching their soul, and he's bringing them out. He's bringing them out. And that's all he wants to do. You know, he's not really worried about, you know, all the accolades and things like that. He's really worried about having an impact and being impactful within his community. And the one that he really, you know, strives to work for is the Filipino community.
Clarkson has another camp scheduled next month, bringing his skills and inspiration to his home court in Utah. After the camp, reports have indicated that Clarkson will be joining the Philippine national team in the next qualifying window as a naturalized player at the next FIBA tournament at the end of August.
Who knows what the future will hold for these young players, but one thing is for certain. Jordan Clarkson not only inspired a generation of hoopers, but a generation of young Filipino-Americans. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Corona, California.
Gilas Pilipinas head coach Chot Reyes is back on the hot seat following the national team's ninth place finish in the recent FIBA Asia Cup. But Coach Chot is unfazed. He believes his players gained a lot from that experience and they'll have a better team for the fourth window of the FIBA World Cup Asian qualifiers next month. And Coach Chot Reyes now joins us here on the program today. Coach Chot, thank you so much for joining us here in ANC.
Hi, good afternoon, Migs. Thanks for having me.
Thank you, Coach. Coach Diaz, Samahang Basketball ng Pilipinas has just released a statement calling on all the stakeholders to come together to support Gilas Pilipinas with the goal of forming a competitive squad for the FIBA World Cup next year. Your reaction to this statement, Coach?
Yeah, that's the only way we can truly put together the best team possible for the World Cup next year. And we have put a lot of plans in place. From last month all the way up to August 2023 already in that regard. And to be able to do that, we really need the help of all stakeholders, PBA, UAP, NCAA, everybody, all the stakeholders in Philippine basketball. Mm.
Now, Coach Chot, I know that you may have answered this question a couple of times already in your previous interviews, but if you were to maybe mention or give an assessment of your FIBA Asia Cup performance for ANC viewers, what would that be, Coach, top of mind?
Obviously, it was disappointing because we wanted to get into the top eight and we failed to do that. However, I said from the start, the number one priority for this competition is to assess the current crop of players. You very well know that we're coming in without a naturalized player. We're playing against teams who have their naturalized players, who have their best players. We brought basically a very young team because we wanted to see who among them, we wanted to see as many players as possible to try them out against top-level Asian competition. And we wanted to find out and assess who among them could make it to the final pool when we put it together. That's why we said, you know, we had very modest goals, at the very least, to get into the top eight. Unfortunately, we didn't do that. And I take full responsibility for it. Mm. But also, just to remind everyone that we have already qualified. I mean, we're all competing in these windows. They're called qualifying windows, but we've already qualified. So, assure the Filipino people that we have already qualified for the World Cup, and all of these competitions that we're playing in is really to get better, to strengthen, and to give exposure to the players that we are looking at making that final roster. Mm.
Now, Coach Chot, with the new reality of players going to different places all over the world, such as Japan or Korea, kasi Coach, previously there would be scheduling differences with Gilas and the PBA. Now you have these other pro leagues outside of the country. Was there any difficulty in getting commitment from the best players due to that? Although the Ravenna brothers and Ray Parks played for Gilas, but were there any difficulties pa, Coach?
Oh, definitely. And you know me, Migs, I'm not one to make excuses. But for example, in the SEA Games, we got Kiefer to join us from his Japan stint, 3 days before we left. Same thing with Matthew Wright coming, although he did not come from Japan, he came from the U.S. But Kiefer, the Ravenna brothers, were only allowed 3 days to come and practice with us because they had to finish their Japan commitments. Dwight Ramos never made it, or wasn't allowed. And the same thing now. We had Ray Parks and 30 Ravenna for the FIBA Asia Cup. They joined practice on July 6 when our first game was July 13. So that's 1 week. And those are the limitations and difficulties that we are facing. But again, we're not making excuses for that, but it is what it is. these are the cards, this is the hand that we're dealt with, and we're making do and trying our best. The good thing in all of this is that the PBA has already committed that they will give us at least 3 months preparation for the World Cup next year. So that means by middle of May or June, we will have access to all the players that we want from the PBA, and which is also the time that the Japan and Korean leagues will be over. So we will have access now to all of those players. So that's what we are preparing for. That is where we are looking forward to having that opportunity where we can come together, full roster and full training time and full practice and preparation time.
Now, Coach, speaking of access and chances, when you talk about the names like such as Jordan Clarkson or maybe Kai Soto, if he will be available, what are the chances of them playing in the fourth window of this tournament?
Well, Jordan has already made himself available. He's already said that. So we're doing everything now that we can we have included him in our lineup, in our roster. So we're looking forward to that. Kai Soto, unfortunately, is still unknown at this point because he still has some certain things that he has to work on back in the U.S. But aside from that, we also have several players from the PBA who are going to be available because by the time the PBA semis would have already been over. So we would have a better pool. And you know, unfortunately, some of our guys who are headed for Korea and so on and so forth would not be with us. But that's the process. And I hope everyone appreciates it. There will be players who are going to be coming and going from now till the World Cup.
Yeah.
But when World Cup competition time comes, we will have the full roster. So I'm just asking for patience from everyone. It's really a very fluid situation now, and it's nobody's fault. Even the leagues like the PBA, for example, they're already rushing their tournaments now. Tinatapos nila ngayon so that they can finish early next year and give us all the time we need to prepare for August 2023. So that's all part of the plan. This is all part of the plan.
Yes.
And unfortunately, we are losing. And of course, you know how it is here, right? Our passionate countrymen hate to see the national team lose. But I hope they continue to focus on the big picture. And yes, that is to put together the best team possible for August 2023.
And leading to that, Coach Chot, I'm sure you're aware of all the online chatter. How do you respond to that? Or what are your reactions to that?
Well, first of all, I'm not on Twitter. I'm not on Facebook. So I am thankfully not aware of it, of course. But siempre the people close to me are telling me. I'm not seeing or reading any of it, although I'm aware of it. So I choose to just focus on my work. I cannot allow those things to distract me, because in the end, I know we have a plan. We have a plan put in place. This is just my fourth month on the job, right? I was given a program with very little. There were hardly any players left when I was appointed on Feb 1. So we are just putting the program back on its feet as we speak. So we're basically trying to fly the plane while we're repairing it at the same time. So, you know, replying and getting distracted by all the online chatter, I don't think is going to be of much help. So I just refuse to get distracted by it.
Lastly, Coach Chot, you mentioned about the program getting back to its feet. And you also mentioned about this recent games as a learning experience. What is your barometer, Coach, that you think that we are improving, we are somehow to that higher level again?
Well, first of all, when we played New Zealand in New Zealand, we lost by 46 points or something. And then in the last game, we lost by just 17 points. Sure, New Zealand, that was a different New Zealand team, but that was not the best Philippine team as well. So I think that's a pretty good barometer that there is growth and that there is improvement. Secondly, the teams that beat us, for example, Lebanon and New Zealand, they're both in the final four of the FIBA Asia Cup, just to show you how strong those teams are. And we competed against them. Yeah, we lost to them, but I thought we competed and we competed hard. Perhaps if we had a naturalized player, perhaps if Dwight Ramos was able to play, it would have been a different story. Not to take away from the efforts of the players who did play, because I thought they really fought gallantly. They fought hard. They gave it their best. And we really should commend them for putting themselves on the line. But certainly there is a lot of growth that we're seeing. Just from the game against India, for example, when we hosted them here a month ago, we won by about 20, less than 20 points. And then when we went there to the FIBA Asia Cup, we blew them out by a larger margin. So we are seeing progress. We are seeing progress. It's just, you know, baby steps for now. But like I said, plans are in place for the best team, for us to put our best foot forward in the 2023 World Cup. So again, to the Filipino people, we are already qualified for the World Cup. So we are using all of these windows to continuously assess and fine-tune and see which players. And that's why we're looking forward to this next window with Jordan Clarkson coming to play and see how he's going to play with some of the other players that we're going to include in this next iteration of the roster.
All right, so there you have it, head coach of Gilas Pilipinas, Coach Shot Reyes. Thank you so much for joining us here in ANC, Coach.
Thank you, Migs.
All right, so that's it from my end. For more sports updates, please do check out ABS-CBN Sports' social media accounts on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and on Twitter. Casey, back to you.
Thanks a lot, Migs. Thanks for joining us today. It's beginning to feel more and more like the pre-pandemic days. Nice to see you again, and take care. Well, before we go, British recording artist Harry Styles will soon become an academic subject. See, Texas State University will offer a course about the former One Direction member and his contribution to pop culture. Styles has broken new records with the release of his third studio album, Harry's House. For more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cbn.com. And that'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.
Prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.